As you know, the 3x2 event is a super challenging endeavor that our colleagues have taken upon themselves to present all of their research in 3 minutes or less, with two slides or less. Marisela Chavez is here to monitor your time. She brought her old-timey cane to drag you off stage if necessary. So she'll be monitoring your time. Watch her closely, because we are going to try to keep it to 3 minutes just to make sure that everyone has a chance to present. I do have up here a list of presenters, so I'm going to ask that each presenter, when you are finished presenting, please introduce the next presenter. There'll also be a slide for them, so you can look at that as well. Exactly. I'm the last one, partly because of that, but also just in case someone needs to get bumped. When Marisela waves her flag, that's 30 seconds left. I know you've all practiced this for the last week, so you're good to go, but that's just in case. So, thank you all for joining us live via CSUDH YouTube as well, by the way, for anyone hearing that for the first time. We'll be having a whole crowd watching from home as well that couldn't make it in person. Might be some last minute no-shows, we'll see. If anyone wants to fill in at the last minute, that's also potentially an option. Dean Lapolt, maybe? No? No? Okay, well. We'll start then with our first presentation of the evening, getting right into it, Dr. Marisela Velazquez. It's a response to domestic pressure of relationships, qualitative findings from judicial attitudes on First Nations and non-Indigenous women who offend. Please welcome Dr. Marisela Velazquez, lecturer in sociology.
Thank you. Hi, good evening. My name is Marisela Velazquez, and first, the research and writing of our paper was conducted on the sovereign lands of First Nations, the Woolgarukaba and the Bindo in Townsville, and the Gimoikiri in Cairns. I pay my respects to the elders past and present, and I extend that respect for any First Nations people who are present here today. Now, our research examines the things judges say about women. What they say about women, how they say about women, and how they discuss women who offend. So through a lens of intersectionality, we focus on the ways indigeneity and gender is understood by judges. Drawing from a broader project, this data involves, it's qualitative data involving interviews with judges from the Supreme and District Courts, courtroom observations from arraignment to the sentence phase, and as well as sentence court transcripts. This field work took place in North Queensland, Australia. You can see it on the block, that the green. Not just Cairns, but below Townsville as well. So first we looked at attitudes by race. So what do judges say about Indigenous people? Then we looked at attitudes by gender. What do judges say about women? And then what do judges say about Indigenous women? So findings demonstrate that judges don't separate race, or they're unable to when they discuss women, they are unable to separate race from gender when they talk about women. When it comes to non-Indigenous white Australian women, judges' attitudes tend to be around victimization lens when they talk about interpersonal violence by women via male intimate partner violence, humanizing attitudes, and gender stereotypical roles. Now, our interview data with judges also shows that specifically when it's talking about Indigenous women, they are positioned and talked about within all sorts of violent type stereotypes, alcohol use, so it becomes difficult to link Indigenous women to femininity. It's these type of attitudes within negative undertones that silence part of the discussion on Indigenous women's intersections of race and gender. So identities like Indigenous motherhood, Indigenous womanhood end up becoming invisible because the focus is on racialized stereotypes. And that's it. Thank you. I'm going to choose to stop there. Thank you very much, everyone. And the next presenter will be Dr. Margarita Landeros, assistant professor in the School of College Counseling. Thank you. Thanks. Great job.
All right. Good evening, everyone. I'm Margarita Landeros. I go by Maggie, here representing on behalf of the School and College Counseling Program. And the research that I'm still wrapping up with one of our current students is around defining, teaching, and empowering leadership for school counselors. And just to give some background, this really stemmed from the fact that the profession has been asking school counselors to be seen as leaders and step into their leadership, but there's not a lot of research that really captures the experiences of school counselors within their respective sites and being leaders or being considered an extension of the leadership team at their institution. So our study is seeking to explore how current school counselors perceive their own respective readiness to be school leaders and how counselor training programs can better prepare future school counselors to step into their leadership. We're hoping that the findings will provide school counseling training programs more information in terms of how do you best prepare school counselors to step in to their leadership in a time where there's been an ask from the state to really prepare counselors for this capacity, but not, again, very limited research available. We also hope to be able to increase opportunities for learning for current school counselors who are out of their programs to step into leadership and administrators who supervise counselors to be able to see them as an extension of their team. And so we have three research questions, again, really looking at what do school counselors perceive to be leadership and within their respective role and how does it show up in our schools? How do counselors describe leadership and speaking to their own leadership? And ultimately, what recommendations might they have around how school counseling programs can better support the teaching and empowering of school counselor leaders? So we conducted 17 semi-structured interviews of current counselors in the state of California, and that's just being that we understand the requirements that the state has for the counseling credential. And we recruited participants through our own alumni database along with other networks. So we're still in the process of transcribing our data, analyzing our data, but just preliminary findings that wanted to highlight around definition. School counselors define leadership by way of advocacy and counselors being relationship builders and that being so keen to other ways in which we think of leadership. Along to understand that school counselors are managers of systems within the respective setting. And just to highlight as I wrap up, you know, around teaching, the one I wanted to call out was, you know, for training programs to be able to teach counselors, how do they engage in conflict mediation with adults, being that they're oftentimes the middle person within school sites. And around teaching, empowering counselors to be able to speak of their work in connection to the larger school priorities. I'll pause there and thank you all. I'll now welcome Dr. Jerry Moore from Anthropology.
Thanks so much, Maggie. And also, I just heard from our audiovisual crew that we have a very powerful microphone. So holding it around here would just be ideal, apparently, for our viewers from afar. Just a note. And there you go, Jerry.
Kind of like a Dean Martin sort of thing? Yeah. Oh, okay. Okay. Good evening, everyone. For millennia, traditional Andean cultures have created diverse landscapes in distinctive ways, ranging from ontological conceptions in which mountain peaks, volcanoes, and springs were named agents that had will, to infrastructural creations such as irrigation canals, agricultural fields, and road networks. And a striking example of this is the Great Wall of Santa on the north coast of Peru. Known since the 1930s, when the Shippey Johnson aerial survey photographed it and other archaeological features in Peru, the Great Wall of Santa is approximately 120 kilometers or 75 miles long, built from adobe bricks, mud mortar, and stone. And to provide some reference, this is approximately the distance from Manhattan Beach to San Bernardino. So it's a major pre-Hispanic construction, but there's only one problem. No one knows when it was built. In collaboration with Dr. Sachiko Sakai at Cal State Long Beach, our research will determine the age of the Great Wall of Santa using optically stimulated luminescence, or OSL, dating. This method determines how long it's been since a grain of quartz or feldspar was last exposed to sunlight. Pending funding, we hope to collect this summer a dozen OSL samples from selected segments of the Great Wall of Santa and determine their age. We hope that this will then lead to an expanded dating program funded by NSF or other agencies. Which leads to a final but rather obvious point. In archaeology, it's generally impossible to know why something was built if you don't know when it was built. It may be that the Great Wall was constructed during a period of social unrest and violence, or during a sustained era of environmental instability, and alternative hypotheses might point to other explanations. But first, we need to know when the Great Wall of Santa was built, and that's what our research will attempt to do. Thanks very much. Let's see, who's next? Killen Lee, there we are.
Thank you. Hello, good evening, everyone. So unlike other presenters, I'm not here to share my own research. So I really appreciate the organizers allow us to take the time to share some resources for our social science faculty and the students. So. Yeah, so what I'm going to introduce will be the SSRIC, the Social Science Research and the Instructional Council. It's the oldest affinity group within CSU. And actually, I was just asking around earlier. Not everyone is very familiar with this council. So what they do is each campus will contribute to the budget every year. And we use a budget for a lot of activities, as you can see here, for both faculty and students. So I want to highlight a few things that's happening every year. So first, we'll provide 3,000 each award for teaching, for providing teaching resources for faculty. So we call that instructional material grant. So basically, the faculty would submit the teaching modules and materials or exercises and activities for a proposal. And then each award will, you know, receive $3,000. And then another resource for faculty would be the summer stipend to attend the ICPSR summer workshop. So that stipend is going to cover the stipend, the tuition for the summer workshops. That also happens every year. And for students, we host an annual student conference, which we call Social Science Student Symposium. That happens in the first week of May every year. And they rotate across different CSU campuses. And from the student conference, we also award students for their quality work, the paper awards. So a highlight from that is, I think the most recently, we had master students from our sociology department won the student paper award like 2 years in a row. And there are other resources, as you can see from the chart there. So there are like database subscriptions and also some travel grants for students to go to a conference. So this is a website. I want to highlight that in less than two years, so the Social Science Student Symposium actually is coming to our own campus. And we are very excited because it has not happened in a very long time. And so our campus will be hosting this event. And I also took a screenshot of the website. So please go there to check it out. And so our council is very inclusive, and we want to include, you know, different programs, and we encourage diverse methodologies. So on our own campus, I can think of, you know, programs in like human services, and also in College of Public Health and Business, and also in College of Humanities. Because I used to get contact email from like a history faculty, because they were using the databases to analyze some historical data. And also another good news is that a long-term leader of the council, Billy, so he is like a new department chair for sociology. So he just got our campus this year, and I myself serve as a campus representative for this council. So if anyone have any questions, please email me or Billy, and we are very, you know, happy to answer any questions. And please also subscribe to the email, and we promise we will not send email that very often. So you only get like a few announcements each year. So that's my presentation. Thank you. Our next presenter will be Kim Proctor from Psychology Department.
Wow, apologies for being late, so I'm having to catch up, walking in the door. So I am going to read so I can meet the time limit, so I apologize for that now. So I am conducting research with two colleagues from the Department, the School of Education and the School of Human Services and Nursing. So, the purpose of the study is to understand how undergraduates define and practice wellness, and to examine differences in how wellness practices impact first generation versus non-first generation students, and to identify which factors are most influential in well-being. So it was a mixed method study. We're actually still conducting research. There was a focus group and a multidimensional survey. So we based our survey on a multidimensional wellness model that includes 8 dimensions of wellness. We analyzed 7 of those dimensions, including emotional, physical, social, spiritual, intellectual, psychological, and environmental wellness. So the focus group included 9 open-ended questions centering on the definition of wellness. So there were questions like, how do you focus on your own wellness and self-care, and how often do you practice that wellness? The multi-scale survey asked questions including the 7 dimensions of wellness, including barriers to college, social-emotional dimensions, and factors that are academic self-efficacy and physical health. So the preliminary results were for the quantitative portion, which as of July included 217 CSUDH students. 167 of those were first-gen college students, 48 were non-first-gen students. We ended up dropping 2 students because they identified as, we don't know if we're first-gen or not. So the first-gen students were significantly lower in well-being versus the non-first-gen students. And past well-being, academic self-efficacy and belonging were identified as predictors of well-being. The qualitative portion of our study included 10 focus group participants, and they defined wellness as an overall health and/or mental health. The students expressed greater focus on well-being after mental health crises, and in addition to that, there were students who had more unique responses that their self-care had to do with doing makeup or playing video games. When asked what their go-to action for mental stress was, 4 respondents said that they used some form of media, so scrolling a device. So that was surprising. So I really made this short. That's it. If you're interested in knowing more about the research, or you want to give the research to your students to take the study, we actually have 376 participants as of now. We're hoping to get about 500. And the good news is that the 2% of our student body at CSUDH is reflective across majors, across gender and across ethnicity. So it is reflective of our college. So camresearch.csu@csudh. And now I would like to introduce Dr. Nestor Garza.
Well, all right. Today we're going to talk about in-kind development contribution in housing supply. This case study is of sidewalks in Seattle. Essentially, this is the idea. The city of Seattle has a regulation where if you have a building permit with more than 6 housing units per permit in certain areas of the city, you have to build, design, and construct the sidewalk out of your own budget. The problem is the same rule applies to certain sections of the city generally. It doesn't matter if you build 6 or 10 or 1 unit. In those cases, you always build the sidewalk. So there's a discontinuity in the regulation. In some cases, the threshold is 6 or more. In other cases, there is no threshold. So we're going to use this discontinuity linear regression to try to identify that idea. Now, the idea comes from a theoretical construct. We have 2 theoretical constructs. Theoretical construct number 1 is, if the restriction operates in a small area, and as a developer, I can substitute the construction, being below the threshold, never paying for the sidewalks, and then build the extra unit somewhere else, I will do it. And in that case, what I'm doing is decreasing the supply of housing in the entire city. Option 2, if the restriction operates on a big area, me as a developer, I cannot change that situation, so I have to develop the corresponding number of units, whatever it was, and design and build the sidewalks, which in addition is what the city needs. The city needs the sidewalks. It's surprising the city like Seattle has, we calculated like 120 years ahead to try to build all the sidewalks it requires. At this pace that they're going, they will never complete them. So how do we do it? The 2 models are going to be tested using data for the city of Seattle. The data is going to include all the housing construction permits in the period 2015 to 2018. We locate them all, and then we locate them all in relation to the regulation, in relation to the lack of sidewalks, and in relation to the urban villages. Those colorful areas that we are marking there are urban villages, where the sidewalk is always required, regardless of the number of housing units. Any location outside the urban villages is exposed to substitution. Any location inside the urban villages is not exposed to substitution. If we are right, we should observe an effect of the regulation that decreases the number of housing units when they are above 6, and increases the number of housing units when they are below 6. If you merely check the information, like in this graph we're reporting here, there is no such rupture, because it cannot be easily observable because it's not modeled. So we model it. We use a stepwise process to select 10 control variables, which I'm reporting down here as yes, meaning yeah. Lots of control variables that explain the amount of housing units per permit. And then we check the result of the pure regulation. And the result or the regulation operates as we expected. Negative from above, positive from below. The impact is about 75% of a housing unit per permit. Or in other words, around 350 less or fewer housing units in the city of Seattle during the period of study. So it's a reduction of the supply and an increase of the price. Thank you. Next is Dr. Anupama Joshi. Child development.
Good evening. My name is Anupama Joshi, and I study development or change over time in humans, specifically from the age of 7 to 11 years of age. All theories of development note that there is no change without tension or pressure. In relationships, that pressure comes in the form of interpersonal opposition that is manifested as quarrels, arguments, or conflicts. Interpersonal conflicts are opportunities for children to both practice and acquire their conflict resolution skills. These skills are consistently linked to children's overall social adjustment, especially in their peer group. I've attempted to get answers to some basic questions. What strategies do children use in their everyday conflict with friends? Are these strategies related to the ones that they see their parents using with them? Are these strategies related to how children feel about themselves? And are there any cultural differences? The findings are complicated, as expected, with a few surprises. There was no connection between conflict resolution strategies used by parents with children and children's strategies with friends. This bolsters the argument that different relationships are contexts that are significantly different, and children respond to those differences. Another finding is that while theory expects that children should begin to use compromise more frequently by 11 or 12 years of age, that is in fact not the case. Indeed, even adolescents rarely use compromise. The most used strategies are assertion, which is repeating one's viewpoint, and discussion, which is explaining one's viewpoint. Aggression is rarely used, at least by children from middle and upper middle classes. Girls are more likely to overtly mark the end of a conflict by saying sorry and giving each other a hug than boys, who seem to understand that a quarrel is over when one asks the other if he would like to watch TV or play video games. Children's self-concept was unrelated to the strategies they chose. I replicated my US study in India and found many similarities. Assertion and discussion were the most frequently used strategies. I found some differences too. First, third-party intervention, which is getting help from someone else to resolve the conflict, occurred more or with greater frequency. The third party was typically friends. Some children in the Indian sample used the silent treatment, which was not found in the US sample. All these findings are for children from the middle and upper middle class, and we have no information about everyday conflicts between children growing in the context of poverty. So that will be my next investigation. Thank you. And I would like to invite Dr. Horace Krugman.
Thank you. So I will do a presentation on the role of a good research mentor for undergraduate. As many of us are aware that most of us as mentors expect to have a deep knowledge of our subject matter, because one of the things we want to do is to guide students. But at the undergraduate level, it is important that we show patient understanding, because there's often a learning curve that must happen. So in other words, the first thing I would say, the characteristic of a good mentor also would show accessibility, which is the ability to be approachable. A lot of times, many of us are not approachable. One of the way of not being approachable is setting grading criteria, GPA criterias. That tends to eliminate a lot of students right away. And I think when we set GPA criteria, we are failing our students, right? A lot of times, if your students are students with high GPA, a lot of times they don't really need your mentorship. It is useful to them, but those who really need your mentorship are those who are at the bottom of the GPA scale. And those are what you do, because research data have shown that when students receive good mentor, they're retained, they reach the graduation rate, and their grades improve. So then that means everyone that is a good research mentor would not have trouble in mentoring weaker students as they mentor good students. And building a team with good and weak students create a successful, I would say, mentorship group. The other thing is the role a good mentor play. One, we are educators, so it teaches basic research skill from doing literature reviews to designing experiments. So these are things that we have to do. Also, a navigator helps students to understand academic pathways and research, right? A lot of us also act as advisor as we are mentors, and also connectors to introduce students to broader academic and professional networks. So one of the things that we also must encourage our students to do is to do presenting of ideas, even when giving them search, literature review search, have them do a presentation to begin to prepare them for conferences, because that's where they will do things like networking and so forth that will take them on to the next level. Sorry, I'm slow at this. I'm a little bit nervous. the impact of a good mentor. One of the things we are doing is giving fun. Hello? Somebody said something? Oh, I'm sorry. I have super ears. Foundational skills to build strong research, such as critical thinking, academic writing skills. Also, inspiring academic passion. And in order to inspire academic passion, we also have to be passionate. A lot of times, many of us are too restrictive in our own being. So that makes us also not very approachable. Some of us are too elitist, so that makes us not approachable. And some of us have a big ego that makes us too not approachable. In other words, we create this thing within our undergraduate of kind of telling them they don't belong when we are all these things. What you call this syndrome? Yes, because the fact is we are all PhDs. And a lot of times, the way we speak to our student, we turn them off. So we also have to learn to remember that they have not yet progressed along these paths. So we have to have a language that is inviting, supportive, and so forth, encouraging at every step. And finally, I would just say something. I just got a paper just accepted for publication just 3 days now, and it's a paper where I'm challenging the whole grading system in the US. Right? So if you guys have time, read it. It's in the Journal of Educational Science. Okay, thank you.
Hi, everyone. Today I'm going to talk about the project that we started in 2017 with the community of San Sebastian del Monte, which is a community in Oaxaca, Mexico. And one of my collaborators is Feliz Cortés. So a dictionary, as you might know a dictionary, right? So a dictionary is part of a language documentation project normally. But historically, dictionaries are projects done on their own. And as linguists, we all can agree that it presents two problems. The first one is misrepresentation of information if the community is not involved in writing it, and the other is lack of self-sustainability. Moreover, PhD students in linguistics are not trained in writing dictionaries, and even less information are available on how to do a dictionary project in a project led by an indigenous community, which is what a reclamation project in simple terms is. So what we are going to do, we are proposing that a dictionary project should not be done on its own, but rather should be part of a bigger project. Oops. So what we are doing is a collaboration between the community and the linguistic community at CSUDH. All the topics, objectives, and priorities and methodologies are decided in consultation with the members of the community and the roles of the members of the CSUDH linguistic community, which currently is me and some undergraduate and graduate students, is of support and knowledge beneficiary. The goals of this bigger project is documenting and revitalizing the language, train and educate new generations of people working with the language, create material to be used to learn and teach the language, and create a dictionary and an overall project that is self-sustainable one day. And finally, we want to build what we call conscientización lingüística, which is an awareness of why we are even doing all of this in the first place. And so if you think of the bigger plan, the dictionary is just a component of it where everything feeds in and some things are extrapolated from. And what our idea of this big language reclamation plan for this specific community, Mixtec community, looks like is the dictionary in the middle and then a lot of other projects going on around, which is not commonly done, but that we find to be helpful because people get to be involved in whatever they actually enjoy doing, because not everyone, believe it or not, likes to write dictionaries. And so you can have children's storybooks and extract words and insert them in the dictionary. You can have pedagogical material and extract words and put in the dictionary. You can have theoretical understanding of Mixtec language, like sounds or sentence formation, and feed into the dictionary. And you can also do general language documentation, like the project that we're starting now on documenting how native plants are used by the community. Likewise, the dictionary is actually helping us now because it's a simpler project of all the other components of this bigger plan to create community workshops, so workshops that can help us to learn more about the language altogether, as well as training our community members and research assistants at CSUDH. And of course, you know, we always have to do archiving and grant writing, otherwise all these little plans are not gonna work. So this is a little bit of what our take on language reclamation looks like in this specific community in Oaxaca. Thank you. Next up, Dr. Donna Nicol.
Good evening, everyone. The correct title, and this is my mistake, is supposed to be Counter-Race Philanthropy in U.S. Education, but I was sick at the time and a little high on pain meds, so this is what you got. all right. So Counter-Race Philanthropy is a form of conservative philanthropy which began in the 1940s as a repudiation against New Deal liberalism in the form of policies by Roosevelt, like desegregating the defense industry, like the appointment of the black cabinet, Truman with the desegregation of the armed forces, and Eisenhower by calling in the National Guard in Little Rock in 1957. And so a number of conservative groups were appalled by these race liberal policies. And so because of a change in the tax code in the 1940s, which allowed for nonprofit foundations to come into existence, corporations started to take advantage of this tax code change and started to fund projects which I call counter-race philanthropy. That means it's distinct from traditional race philanthropy that was supposed to be used in support of helping to advance the race. Now, mind you, those projects are problematic sometimes, but in this case, counter-race philanthropy is explicit in trying to counter the advancement of certain groups as an economic protectionist policy. They're basically trying to use race as a wedge issue to scare people because they want to protect their economic interests. This philanthropy uses a political economics race capitalism framework that seeks to limit educational opportunities for certain groups. They use racial dog whistling. They have this kind of just public opposition to anything multicultural or anything equity-based. And so we've been talking a lot in circles in education about critical race theory, getting rid of ethnic studies programs, but in order to understand how we got there, we need to know the history. So this is a two-part book project. comes from my dissertation research more than 20 years ago. And so the first part is more or less written, just needs to be revised. And so that will take us through the death of affirmative action in California in 1996. And then the second part of the project will be the contemporary part of the project that goes from 96 up until basically Ron DeSantis and current critical race theory projects. So I'm looking at how money is being used to get rid of conversations about race in education. Thank you. Next up is Tieli Wang. Did I say that correctly?
Yeah, so the topic of my presentation is the anti-tumor effect of temozolomide. Temozolomide, it is an anti-cancer drug. It is a prodrug that can undergo pH-dependent degradation. First, produce this intermediate we called methyltriazinine imidazole carboxamide, which is subsequently degraded to produce this methyldizonium, which is active methylating agent. The therapeutic benefit of temozolomide has been known depends on its ability to methylate DNA, especially at nitrogen and oxygen in the guanine residues. This methylation damages DNA and triggers the death of tumor cells. What we believe, this methylation or this therapeutic benefit can also extend to protein level. This has never been proposed before because protein, they are the executor of biological function and are estimated in magnitude of numbers, dynamics, and complexity greater than genes. Thus, they play a functional diversity roles in biological system and a good target for drug discovery. The protein we believe that can be the target of temozolomide, it is histone and its associated proteins. Why? Because histone provides structure support for chromosome. Each chromosome contains a long DNA molecules. In order to fit this long molecule of DNA into a small space in the nucleus of the cells, you have to wrap it around histone protein. And because of that, any change in the structure of histone, for example, methylation, will significantly impact the gene regulation, gene expression, and genomic stability. And we did identify in vitro using recombinant protein. And we showed that TMZ does methylate protein in vitro. And then next, I started this project when I was doing sabbatical in Mount Sinai Medical School. And I used mass spectrometry to identify this methylation level in the protein level in vitro. And then this project was continued in the Dominguez Hill campus by implementing the project into the chemistry laboratory. And we did show the TMZ also methylate the histone protein in breast cancer and brain cancer cells. And our next project, it is to identify or determine if this cancer drug can also impact the activity of histone demethylase. And we already implanted this project into the clinical chemistry labs. And the result I will present next year. Thank you.
All right. Hi, good evening, everybody. My name is Ashley Membre. I'm in the psychology department, and I will be presenting a project about gig worker experiences. So the use of gig work, the use of independent contractors is a growing sector of employment in the United States. And so there are a lot of different terms that people can use, gig workers, gig economy. So is there kind of like a clear definition? And so this one quote provided here is from a systematic review by Carpentano and colleagues. So gig work is labor contracted and compensated on a short-term basis to organizations or to individual clients through an external labor market. So you think about like rideshare programs such as Lyft and Uber, for example. But then in terms of individual clients, think about if you want your TV mounted on a wall, you can call somebody up on TaskRabbit to perform that for you. So in terms of the use of independent contractors or gig workers, so kind of part of the appeal of it might be that there's increased autonomy. So rather than your traditional work of a standard 9-to-5, I can decide my own hours, when I want to do this and whatnot. But there's a trade-off with that. So with the use of gig work, you have that lack of employee protections, that legal contract that you have to sign does not exist in a gig work context. And so are there kind of paths to reduction of like experiences of discrimination that you might have in traditional employment, like going to HR. HR doesn't necessarily exist in these contexts. And so there might be increased vulnerability for marginalized workers in this case, trading off that autonomy for less ability to protect themselves. So there also is some research out there when it comes to disabled workers specifically, for example, in terms of gig work being a boon to them, but then there might be some trade-off for other types of workers. Particularly for my field of industrial organizational psychology and also for business and management, there's a really big lack of representation for kind of non-white collar work or work for or experiences outside of like the management context or for leaders. And so with the gig, kind of the gig economy, gig workers being a growing field, this would be a very, you know, great subject for us to look at. And so how is this going to be done? So I have a grant from the California Labor Lab who collected this large population data set through their use of their California Work and Health Survey. So there are about 4,000 participants in this data set, and within that, about 296, so around 300 of them, are gig workers. And so in terms of the variables of interest that I would like to look at, so particularly in terms of stress predicting health outcomes, so physical health, mental health, demographic differences, so comparisons for gender, race, and then organizational contextual factors. So is the surveillance that they might be under, can that exacerbate their experiences with stress and health outcomes, as well as personal contextual factors. So if somebody has caregiving responsibilities on top of that, their work in this independent contract, does that also, you know, add on to their stress, as well as, you know, financial stability? All right, and that's it. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Ashley. So Kai just let me know that he's unfortunately facing an emergency right now, so he won't be able to make it. So this is the chance for Koi or Steve or Aaron or Dean Lapolt to step up and give a 3-minute presentation. Michelle? No? All right, anyone? Okay, well. All right, here we go, Aaron. Thank you so much. Oh, wait, sorry, the catch is you have to present Kai's slides. There you go.
Okay, so I'm not gonna present Kai's slides. my name is Dr. Aaron McCauley. I am a researcher in the chemistry and biochemistry department, and my research is on natural products, small molecules from nature that have some sort of pharmaceutically relevant activity. So we have a large library that we have been donated and have grown ourselves over the last couple of years that consists of a whole bunch of different marine-derived fungi and marine-derived sponges. And these small molecules, we grow them up, we extract them, we screen them in a bunch of different assays. So in our lab right now, we have some cancer cells, we have some breast cancer cells and brain cancer cells. We had some pancreatic cancer cells, but they died. And so we take these extracts from these different marine sponges and fungi, and we test them against those cells. And if they kill them off, we're very interested in how they killed them off. So the first thing we have to do is purify them and figure out their structures. We also have a series of collaborators that we work with at the Henry Ford Cancer Center to kind of further those small molecules that we discover and figure out like how they were moved through the body. So your ADME, absorption, distribution, metabolism, and extraction. And we work with a lab up at the University of California, Santa Cruz, that's looking for small molecules that target something called a type 3 secretion system. So it's a novel target for antibiotic drug development. But the reason that I'm up here talking really quickly is because we recently, in the chemistry department, have purchased two new mass spectrometers. We have a high-resolution, high-accuracy Orbitrap mass spectrometer and a MALDI-TOF mass spectrometer that's capable of doing a whole bunch of different things. So if in any of your guys' research you're thinking that at some level it would be nice to know what the chemistry is that's inside of your samples or the changes in the chemistry that's inside of your samples, please come talk to me, and I would love to figure out how we can help you with that. Next, we have Elise Freeman. Okay. Oh, sorry, and Monique Turner.
All right, hello everyone. We'll be tag teaming today. So as you can see, we represent, I represent the library as well as the kinesiology department from a faculty standpoint, and Monique with the psychology department. But in addition to that, we also represent our campus Toro Esports Academy. So I'm sure there's been a lot of buzz that's been ringing in your ears about esports. And so with that, we represent the health and wellness aspect of it. And so together, we recognize that we have a unique position here on campus with our educational backgrounds to feed into our esports campus community. And so if you do not know, esports is built upon five pillars here on campus, and it's these that we have listed here. But of these five pillars, we believe that health and wellness fits into four out of five of these components. And so what we would like to do is just kind of show you a way in which we are taking our educational background and finding ways to navigate different sectors from psychology, kinesiology, and hoping we could have other collaborators help us find ways in which we could challenge the students' minds to see that esports isn't just about gaming. And if you don't make it pro, or if you're not the person creating the games, there's other ways that you could implement your educational background with your passion. And so this is one way in which we are doing it now.
Thank you. So through our workshops over the past, I would say 3 years that we'll go over shortly, we actually came up with this model. I love flowchart visual representations, so I tried to see how we could kind of combine it together. And so you have psych, and then you have kinesiology. We also had a partner that was in occupational therapy, but we just kind of coupled that within kinesiology. And so I really focus on positive psychology, emotion regulation, cognitive aspects. So really teaching our students how to perceive their environment, how to engage in coping skills, and also to regulate their emotions. And then kinesiology is focused on assessment, injury prevention, ergonomic evaluation, and also physical fitness. So we did a lot of workshops and got feedback from our e-athletes, and we noticed that there was a decrease in their activity, academic abilities, and then also their interactions with others, especially during the pandemic. And so they were really becoming isolative and depressive. And so we kind of combined this model, and then we have this aspect in the middle focused on communication and team building. So in order for them to connect, they have to do exercises. And so we have to communicate with our stakeholders, parents, faculty, staff, and then also they must communicate amongst each other. And so really taking this model and applying it to e-athletes, but it can also be applied to many different sectors as well, in other high school students, and things of the such.
And so with this, this final slide just gives you guys an overview of our history of events. So we have been at this since 2020. We did have a shorter period of time in 2022 because the lab was being built at that time and we went through some structural changes. But some things I would like to point out that we have done, many of which can be found on YouTube because they were live stream. We've done educational talk sessions. So for example, one of our first ones, Monique actually did, which was on esports training, which was in regards to thinking positive. We have also talked about other things such as microaggressions. We have done in-person workshops when it came to ergonomic assessments and evaluations. If anybody was here last year, you know that I'm really big on prolonged sitting and making sure people like stand and not sit forever. So that was some of my thesis research. And so we're incorporating that as well into this, making sure that students who sit all day and then they game all day and then likely they're at home all day sitting, find ways to get more active because we already know that it helps when it comes to their physical and their mental wellness. And so this is just some of the things that we have done thus far. And so you're more than welcome to check any of it out on YouTube. And outside of that, we have other networks and things that kind of display some of the work that we have done, including a poster presentation that we are really proud to say we just presented on last week at the Southwest American College of Sports Medicine Regional Conference. So that actually fulfills part of our academics and research component for our pillars. So we're really excited about that. And so we have more research ideas, and we are open to collaborating with many of you here, or if you know somebody who might be interested, please feel free to reach out to us and let us know. Thank you so much. All right, and Dr. Terry McGlynn.
Thanks. My notes. I trust you, but I'm still timing myself. Thank you. Hi. Thank you for your time. So there's a lot of stuff going on in my lab, but I'll tell you about the one that that needs your help. So this project that I'm working on in my lab involves this animal. The goal of this project is to connect people in our community with nature and biodiversity where they live in the city with the students and scientists here on our campus who are investigating urban biodiversity to understand the connections among all of these things. And we're doing this through the lens of this charismatic animal, which is the harvester ant. So this species has been super duper widespread all over the region historically. But then as the city grew, invasive species arrived. We would plow over soil, we'd put in trees, we would introduce irrigation, which would foster other species from other areas, which would take over. And so this became less and less common. And so you might know this as a red ant, is what the common name locally around here. But what they do is they collect seeds from various kinds of plants, and then they eat the nutrients from those seeds. And they're also an important prey source for horned lizards. And so they're a cool, interesting, charismatic species that's around here. People see, oh, that's kind of cool, which is, this is actually the animal that you get if you were to purchase Uncle Milton's ant farm. It's actually this species. And so, but it's no longer that common around the city, but you find it in patches here or there. And we want to find out where these are because that's valuable information about understanding how urban biodiversity works. And so I can't hire an army of 1,000 undergraduates to walk every sidewalk to find one of these species. But people see these all the time and get interested. And so I have a collaborative project with the Natural History Museum of LA County, who I work with very closely on this. And so whenever anyone sees one of these, we hope that they share a record with us. And so there's this app called iNaturalist. I don't know how many of you know iNaturalist on your phone. But if you have iNaturalist, if you see one of these ants, take a photo, upload it to iNat, which takes you just 30 seconds of your life, and that gives us data. And so as of right now, as of this month, here are all the iNat records of harvester ants that are found in the middle of the city. We're doing a cleanup along Compton Creek, like behind Best Buy, and there are harvester ant colonies. It's kind of amazing. And so our goal is not only to create information about biodiversity to help us understand how urban ecosystems work, but also to create connections with people and their communities to understand local biodiversity and have conversations with students in our community who are in training as scientists. Thank you very much. If you'd like, now we're at the break time. If you'd like a Harvester Hunt sticker, I have stickers. Be sure to tell everybody. And when you see Harvester Ants, please put them on INAP. Thanks. No
sticker. Good evening, everyone. In the spirit of collegiality, I want to say that my research came from a collegial conversation with Andrea Johnson in the history department. You might know Andrea. She knows I like to research architecture, church architecture. She said, what do you think of megachurches? I was like, what do I think of megachurches? And that stimulated this entire project. Just a really friendly, fun, in-between class kind of conversation. So my title, Architecture of the Unremarkable, you know I'm going to challenge that. But I have a question for you. It's late. Here's your quiz question. Where's the church in that photograph? In the sky. Okay. That question is simple but deadly when it comes to this study of megachurches. So that is a photograph of Saddleback Community Church in Lake Forest and the Rick Warren's church. The mega church, I will propose for my argument, is very remarkable because you can't even use the old terms anymore to describe this entity, this project of a mega church. And much of that is tied to a simple fact of architecture. Architects design for clients. Simple. The architect meets the client's needs. The building is built, it's twice as much as what was said, and the story is over, right? So the mega church is really a product of a very significant change amongst the evangelical Christian communities in what people would do at church, who comes to church, and how many times a week people might come to church, and some other ideas. A lot of this I have found through my research is connected to a church growth movement, which is sort of in the 50s, continuing 70s, 80s, where people came together and evangelical Christians came together and just decided there was an impulse to bring unchurched people to church. So unchurched people could be people who'd never been to church, people who had been to church and didn't like it, people who didn't like their parents' church, all these different ideas. So when you start to look at the architecture supports several ideas, the campus being one of them. The accessibility, note the cars. It is Southern California. You better have a parking space when you go here. And the other buildings you see, I guess you could call the building in the back the main, what we would call the main church, represent other spaces, architectural spaces, design spaces for all of these different activities. Children's spaces, teen spaces, gift shops, coffee kiosks, challenging the notion of the single church worship center. And here we have a photograph, an interior view. There's very little there that suggests church in terms of your familiar iconography, crosses, altars, screens within a Christian context. And that is very much intentional, and it does drive the architecture, because one of the ideas here is that the comfort level for people is enhanced when their familiar environments maybe even look like an auditorium where you're going to hear a rock concert sometimes, or there's a lot of music, video in the mega churches, and we could discuss the way the services are somewhat informal and are kind of a different approach to Christianity. But I'm looking at the architecture, and the other thing I have seen, is that a sacred space or a secular space, or does it even matter anymore? And if you come back to the first slide, that might have looked like Costco to you or a mall. And there's very much an intentional borrowing of commercial forms in the megachurch architecture. And
while we might find that kind of off-putting, it doesn't look sacred to me. It's not, you know, the church in the woods with the cross or any things you could think of. It is a really radical move on the in the history of Christian architecture. So I would propose it's highly remarkable in some ways because it doesn't look familiar or remarkable anymore. Thank you. And I think our next, Dr. Carrie Patterson.
Hi, thanks. I'm Kari Peterson. I'm from the chemistry department, and I'm just going to give you like the background for my research today as opposed to trying to show you any results. So my goal is to understand the immune response kind of from a structural molecular level. So the molecules that I'm particularly interested in are sugar molecules that are actually coating the surface of all of the cells in your body, and they're involved in working with a lot of different factors, and the two that I'm most interested in are the inflammation system with chemokines and infectious diseases. So in particular, right now I'm focusing on the infectious disease, particularly with a protein from the HIV virus. But when these sugar molecules interact with pathogens, they can interact in basically four different ways that allow it to facilitate, and three of those facilitate incorporation of the virus into the cell, right? Because that's what's needed for viral replication. They don't have their own ability to replicate, or in blocking antimicrobial peptides. So the reason why this is a little bit challenging is because these sugar molecules are not like one structure. So what I have here is just like three of the possible structures. And the one I look at is called heparin sulfate. And even within the structure of heparin sulfate, we use these cartoons here because the structure is just like, it's just like a mess of letters and lines and it doesn't make any sense. So we use cartoons a lot. This is the heparin sulfate like disaccharide unit. This is a tetrasaccharide. So here's your disaccharide unit. And you can see that within this, we have a glucosamine and an adrenic acid. It's just two different six-membered ring sugar molecules. And each of these X's represents a place where a sulfate group can get added. So even though we have this repeating disaccharide unit, there's all these different places where sulfates can get added. And even within a single chain, you might not have like the same sulfation pattern at every place. So you basically have a really heterogeneous structure. And all we know is that there's so many proteins that interact with these heparin sulfate molecules. But is there like a specific sequence that is preferred by a certain protein over a different one? And if it binds to this, is that gonna block it from ever leaving? Like, is it really strongly affinity? Or does it have a really strong affinity? Or are there some that if we had this structure, then it would interact with all three or four or five or six of these equally? So the particular protein that we're interested in studying right now is this protein right here at the end of the capsid structure for HIV. It's called the matrix protein. And if you look at the image here of the viral capsid, it's basically what's on the outside. So the idea is this is what's on the outside of your viral capsid interacting with the universe of your body. And so we want to find out what is it about heparin sulfate that's binding to that. How is that binding happening? And if we can figure that out at a really specific level, maybe someone else, not me, can go and develop a drug to block that and prevent that infection. And next we have Heather Clark.
All right, thank you, Kari. All right, good evening, everyone. So our teachers in our middle schools and our high schools today spend an average of 4 hours a year teaching climate change, okay? And when climate change is taught, it is taught as a scientific problem with technological fixes. In contrast, our young people today will rank climate change as a major concern and they are racked with eco-anxiety. And depending on who they are, they can tell you if climate change exacerbates the social vulnerabilities they already experience, or if their privileges shield them from the risks. In other words, young people will tell you that climate change is a social justice problem that must be addressed with equitable and just solutions. In my work, I aim to close this gap between how climate change is taught in our schools and how climate change is experienced in the world. As a teacher educator and a researcher of teaching and learning, I work with our current and our future teachers to develop the skills, knowledge, and dispositions to close this gap, to transform their science classrooms into climate justice classrooms. And tonight, I want to share two approaches that I'm investigating with you all. So first, how do we integrate social justice into our science classrooms? One strategy is for teachers to foreground social processes as causal mechanisms in the scientific processes that explain climate change. So that means that students can learn about the structures and systems of our unjust society as root causes of climate change. And when two students are supported in developing these layered explanations of climate change that layer scientific and social justice processes, and those intersections are made visible, they're able to explain climate change more as it's experienced in the world, and they're better prepared to advocate for justice-oriented solutions. Second, how do we help our young people move from anxiety to a place of agency? Teachers of all subject matters can center storytelling and local case studies in their classrooms. So when climate change is framed around meaningful human stories, when children are able to tell and hear stories of how their communities are connected to chains of life in the environment, and when students are able to investigate local cases of success and resilience, these issues all become more relevant, and they're able to imagine possible futures as closer and more conceivable. All of these things support a sense of agency and efficacy. So in parting, I invite you all to consider a future when our teachers are empowered to be part of the solution to climate change. Imagine how much brighter is our future going to be when teachers can support our children in addressing and getting us out of this climate crisis. Thank you. All right, next up, Rita Elias.
Thank you. So actually, I'm going to get immediately into it. When I came here, I had one of my students, and he said, "Oh, hi, miss, I love you. If I can, I would give you money because I know you love money." That's the first presentation about money. And now I wonder, why am I after Heather, which is social justice? Okay, anyway, let's get started. So my research, which strategy, right? Most of our dependent variable is firm performance. Always money, always on the profitability side. So what I study most are CEOs. And in this special project, I'm looking at when we hire CEOs from the outside versus when we promote internal people to become our CEOs, right? So if you look at the money, look at Steven Schwarzman of Blackstone. This person makes $253 million per year. That's their salary. That's their compensation. We would have thought Tim Cook is the highest paid. He's not. Poor guy, only $99 million per year. In our research, what we did is we collected this data about the compensation that is given to CEOs, and we put it in two different buckets, the internally promoted CEOs versus the CEOs brought from outside, because research shows us that to bring a CEO from outside, we have to pay them really high to bring them in. Otherwise, why would they come? They have no incentive. What we found when we did our data collection from WIRDS is if you look at the salary, not the bonus, just the salary of the externally hired, it's lower than the salary of the internally hired. However, the bonus of the externally hired is higher. That's what makes the total compensation of the externally hired actually double the total compensation of the CEOs that are promoted internally. Always, our dependent variable is return on asset, which is the performance of the company. So our hypotheses are the higher the compensation, the higher the return on asset, normal. That's the research tells you that. What we are including is, let's see if this gets moderated by the CEO origin, whether it's internal or external, makes any difference. And what we found, actually, it is different. So if the CEO origin is internally, the higher the salary of the internal CEO, the higher the return. And if the CEO is external, then this relationship between the higher salary, the higher the return, goes down. So they moderated. And what I'm trying to say here is use resource-based view of the firm. Those CEOs are internal. Knowledge is a resource. They have the knowledge. That's why they lead to higher performance. Now we thought, is this the case also? Would this be affected by the company size, not just the origin of the CEO? So company size, we found out that for large companies, there is no effect. And that's why our third hypothesis was partially supported. But for the small and medium-sized companies, this even makes the relationship stronger when the CEO is internal. That's it. Done. Money. And then we go to the next one, Dr. Ha.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Rita. And good evening, everyone. So I'm going to delve into a topic that I always find to be intriguing to me. My research interests really encompass aspects of intellectual property, but also, you know, as a performer, as a musician, and as a composer, I've always been intrigued with copyright law and music and how it's evolved throughout the years. Something that's also intriguing is the aspect of how people in the music world and even outside of the music world, we see this element of disruption since the beginning of the recorded music industry, stemming back to 1877 with Thomas Edison creating the phonograph and the first words being, "Mary had a little lamb," right? And we see things running concurrently with the player pianos and people being in fear of this disruption of how, you know, musicians or performers would be replaced by these machines that actually play themselves, by these piano rolls and these player pianos and things of that nature. And even from then, you know, we see the invention of the radio and how essentially people begin to feel as though, oh my goodness, why would people even go to a concert hall and listen to an orchestra or listen to an ensemble? Because we have this new invention that's extremely disruptive and that will take away from the essence of music, and that's going to be some disruptive invention or, you know, evolution of music. But we find out later that these things are very much important for you know, monetization, for music to be heard by the masses. We see intermediaries and all of these things so that music can be heard.
The bundle of rights. So currently right now, copyright law, you have 6 exclusive rights. And those rights include the right to reproduce music, to prepare derivative works, distribute the work, perform publicly, display the work publicly, perform through audio transmission. As you can see, embodied in these rights that we look at in copyright law, we don't see a lot of flexibility for innovation with artificial intelligence and things of that nature. So we look at some of the implications that comes about when we look at these new areas of focus and these burgeoning aspects that we look at in the area of the music world and the music industry. One implication would be possible revision of U.S. copyright law. And we, you know, also think about something. This is something that, you know, comes to mind. as a possibility. Perhaps the addition of a seventh exclusive right that authorizes copyright owners to train their AI generator to create derivative works, which would allow for greater monetization and innovation. So this, you know, these are the things that we look at. How can we be more inclusive? How can we be more forward-thinking and, you know, not only be more innovative, but also how do we protect, you know, copyright? How do we protect, you know, the music that we have as far as copyright ownership? Limitations. Currently, AI-generated works are not protected by U.S. copyright law. Copyrighted works must have a human author. So I'm sure that's going to be challenged to some degree, right? We're going to have to see how we're going to have to make that more flexible. As of Monday, October 30th, 2023, President Biden signed an executive order for safe, secure, and trustworthy AI. So I think this is an implication to show that it's inevitable, right? Change is inevitable, especially in the music industry. We've seen this disruption throughout history. It's going to continue. We're going to continue to evolve. But how do we, as people in the music world and outside of the music world, allow for this? Innovation that we look at that has taken place currently would be the legendary icon and national treasure, singer-songwriter Roberta Flack, is currently working with her record label, Rhino Entertainment and Andel, an AI company, to celebrate the 50th anniversary of her hit song, Killing Me Softly, using AI for soundscapes for focus, relaxation, and sleep. And I know many of you are familiar with that song, but what you're probably not familiar with is that knowing that Roberta Flack is someone that's currently suffering from ALS. So she's unable to perform, she's unable to really, you know, create new works, but she can reimagine these works using, you know, artificial intelligence. But how can we monetize and how can we create more innovative ways? And we're doing this through new intermediaries, such as Matchtune. Matchtune being an AI company that creates a platform for musicians and artists to be able to take their music and explore it through artificial intelligence, and Indel that I've mentioned before. So I will stop there, and thank you very much. Okay, and next up we have the great, he's number one, Dr. Ken Seligson.
Down to one.
There we go.
Thank you so much, Dr. Weir. We did lose the microphone, unfortunately. Hopefully you can kind of hear me back there. I can try to project. I only have one tone. I'm going to try to send it back there as best I can. I'm going to try to record myself as well, time-wise. So I saved myself for last, partly in case we had to bump someone if we were running over time. The good news for me is that we're 18 minutes under time. So I can
have 18 minutes
to speak. So congrats to you.
Go ahead, Ken.
Exactly. That's where we get started. Well, last year, if you were here, I talked about the first part of our project when we used the lasers, which is airborne laser scanning, to map the forest in a way that we'd never been able to do before. Maya archaeology is completely different in the last 5 years because we can pretty much remove the trees and see all of the ancient structures that are there on the ground floor. It saves years of mapping to then get to the good stuff. I mean, I could stare at one of these maps we're creating, which I'll show you on the next slide, forever, but now we can actually excavate where we know there are structures already. We can kind of skip over that first part. In 2022, I was able to bring Caesar, Astrid, Karen, and Leslie down to do some of the ground truth mapping with me. And then this past summer, Jose, Reese, Diana, and Alyssa came down for the excavations. We were trying to figure out how old is this site that was recently identified with this laser scanning mapping. And so we mapped the center of the site of Shanab Chak based on how it looked in the map. We thought maybe it was from what we call the middle pre-classic period, around 900 BC or BCE, which would have made it one of the earliest small farming settlements in this area, the Puuc region, which has no surface water at all. No rivers, no streams, no lakes, no anything. And it only rains for 6 months of the year. So people had to capture all the water during those 6 months and store it for the 6 months of the dry season. And yet people were living there continuously, we thought, as far back as 2,900 years ago. That's what we were testing this year by excavating into the central platform at the site and in the ball court. Those two parallel structures in the northwest are a Mesoamerican ball court. We had a demonstration on campus last November. Hopefully we'll have one again in the spring where a local ball team comes and plays and demonstrates how it's done. A 12-pound dense rubber ball, pretty much imagine hitting a lacrosse ball, 12-pound lacrosse ball with your hips. Not easy, doesn't look good when I do it. But we excavated looking for these small pieces of pottery that would tell us how old the site was. We got more than we bargained for. On the fourth day of our excavation, we found that figurine. The students were excited. They thought, this is archaeology all the time. This is my first find like that in 13 years. But now they're all going to be cursed to a life in archaeology because of this one thing that we found on the fourth day of their excavation. But now we're trying to figure out what it's doing there because we've only found figurines like that from Guatemala and Belize. We don't know what it's doing up in Yucatan from that early. Maybe it was made in Guatemala and traded up there, or maybe they were emulating what was going on down there. We have to figure that out by doing some INNA analysis, or maybe mass spectrometry analysis on the sample. So we'll hopefully be doing that going into next year, when we're hopefully going to expand the excavations and figure out what this site looked like before this final version. It was abandoned 350 BC around then, but this is probably not what it looked like in 900 BC. We're just seeing the final snapshot. So that's what's going to be happening moving forward, hopefully with the next group of students coming down in summer 2024. So thank you all for being here tonight for the third annual CSUDH 3x2 event. We'll be doing it again next year. It's in the books now. It's archived. It has to happen. But yeah, we'll be hopefully having an even bigger event next year. Hopefully a lot of people tuning in will come and present as well. Thank you all to all of our presenters tonight. Thank you so much. Thank you very much again to Dean Schrager and the Graduate Studies Research. Yeah, you talk to your colleagues from other departments. There's so much going on here. That wide range of presentations. Can you believe it? Oh my goodness. So much is going on across campus. And we hope to see you again around campus for the final weeks of the semester. Good luck, everyone, heading into the home stretch. To our audiovisual crew for capturing all of this for our YouTube crowd. Good night, everyone.
Good night. Good night.